watching CN2 News, your number one source for award-winning hometown coverage.
First responders warning people about potentially dangerous conditions as winter weather moves through the area. I'm CN2's Catherine Andreoli, and I'll have more on what you need to know.
There's no denying it is cold outside, and it's not only affecting us, but also the pipes in our home. I'm CN2's Renee O'Neill with how this company is staying busy in this weather.
Turning over a new leaf in politics, there's a lot of fresh faces in office. I'm CN2's Alexandria Savage speaking with TKK officials who say it's still the good life.
Your news starts right now. Also, our three-part series kicks off tonight called Starting the Conversation. We're looking forward to that.
And thank you for choosing us here at CN2 News. Hello, I'm Lucas McFadden.
I'm Laura Bree Monday. We begin our newscast with a little bit of snow and plenty of cold. Parts of Rock Hill and Lancaster already seeing some light flurries.
Crews are pre-treating roads in several counties and say they're anticipating for weather that could cause some icy conditions for drivers Wednesday night, tonight, into Thursday morning. Now, South Carolina DOT crews say that they're using salt to pre-treat roads throughout Chesterfield and Lancaster counties, mainly along bridges and roads south and east of Highway 522. The weather prompting Lancaster County to cancel all after-school activities this Wednesday. Crews say they're monitoring conditions and have trucks on standby if the weather calls for it. The fire marshal there, Russell Rogers, says Lancaster County could see accumulation and drivers need to use caution.
Just monitoring the weather situation as closely as possible. The further west the storm track happens, the more chance we're going to get of accumulating. We have four-wheel drive trucks that can go around and assess the road situations all over the county.
Crews are also monitoring conditions along I-77 in Chester County and primary routes east of I-77. If you are out on the roads, be sure to drive slowly, of course, and beware of icy conditions later this Wednesday evening.
This freezing weather also impacting schools and roads and, of course, our homes. Local plumbers say their phones have been ringing nonstop ever since the frigid weather came our way. For some homeowners, their pipes are freezing, causing a real mess. CN2's Renee O'Neill catching up with crews this Wednesday and learning how to protect your pipes during this cold snap.
Thank you for choosing Roto-Rooter Plumbers. This is Beth. How can I help you?
Employees with Roto-Rooter Plumbers in Rock Hill working all hours, responding to calls.
Where is the address?
Overnight, we had calls come in, you know, every customer frantically, they have no water.
Billy Hovestat, master plumber with Roto-Rooter, says they've been responding to many frozen pipe calls. He says customers will wake up and find their water isn't running, later learning the pipes are frozen.
Once it warms up just enough, it depends on what kind of pipe it is. You know, if it's copper, if it's brass, if it's galvanized, they're going to break.
He adds with the temperatures getting so low, most any type of pipe can freeze and burst. So to protect your home, open all cabinet doors and let water drip.
But just make sure where you're letting the water drip, make sure it's not a place where the P-trap can be frozen. So if the P-trap freezes, it will overfill and it'll drain water out. So you have to be very cautious to make sure it's warm wherever that's going to be dripping at.
Employees with the City of Rock Hill also adding their call volume is up as they respond to many water-related issues. Crew leader Henry Greer says his crew works to keep themselves safe in the cold so they can make sure customers are taken care of as fast as possible.
You try to just pace yourself, stay warm. Sometimes we'll try to get some coffee to warm up a little bit, maybe get in the truck a little bit. Main thing is you want to make sure you stay dry.
Well, the cold weather definitely affecting many people throughout the Tri-County. Take a look at these photos. These coming from the Lancaster County School District. This is the Buford Bus Office. Leaders say they had pipes burst from the freezing temperatures. And the Lancaster County Fire Marshal also saying that training has been restricted for firefighters. And they are also keeping trucks inside. And if they do have to respond to calls, they keep the water moving in the trucks to prevent freezing and damage. Well, I'm going to get back inside out of this cold. And we hope all of you guys stay safe if you have to be out in it. For now, we're in Rock Hill. Renee O'Neill, CN2 News.
All right, Renee, thank you. The folks with Roto-Rooter say if you have a well, you can also purchase a heat tape or heat lamp to help reduce frozen pipes. They also say to make sure you know where the main water cutoff is so to your house. So if a pipe were to burst, you could turn that water off. And one more point, they say if the water is broken underneath the ground, do not turn it off. Just turn it low until help arrives. Well, take a look at these frozen water fountains throughout the area. Winthrop University sharing a picture of its famous fountain in front of campus. And even though the bottom of Fountain Park is frozen, the top is still working, making for a very pretty picture.
Well, students in Fort Mill will head back to the classroom on Thursday, and school leaders say all Fort Mill schools will operate on a normal schedule tomorrow. As for Lancaster County students, well, they headed back to the classroom today on a two-hour delay. School transportation leaders say they had many temperature-related issues this Wednesday morning with their school buses. They say they had three buses that were down due to frozen lines. Leaders say other working buses had to go back and pick up students, making them have an even later start to their day since, again, that district was on a two-hour delay. Well, because of the cold weather, AAA of the Carolinas is releasing the numbers of emergency roadside service calls the agency has received. This is just for the both Carolinas. So far, crews have responded to 4,400 calls. The average call volume for this time of the year, they say, is about half of that at 2,800. The majority of those calls were for battery-related flat tires as well as lockouts.
An arrest in connection with the death of a three-year-old who died in Lancaster back in December. Lancaster police now charging 25-year-old Kayla Cook with homicide by child abuse in the death of Lillian Schroeder. Authorities say Schroeder was found at her home on December the 18th, lying on her back in the living room unresponsive. According to the official warrant released this Wednesday, Schroeder died from blunt force trauma to her head within minutes of receiving the injury. Cook told investigators she was alone with the young girl while the child's father was at work on the day of the child's death. The York County Coroner's Office releasing the name of the driver who was killed in this three-car crash Tuesday on Heckle Boulevard in Rock Hill. The coroner says 25-year-old Camilla Bulware from Gastonia died in the crash.
Well, fire crews are talking about a life-saving moment. Two local heroes springing into action to save a woman's life after a car fire on Interstate 77 in Rock Hill. Christopher Boatwright was on the interstate, saw the fire, and rushed to save the woman's life. He used that tool right there. It's called a seat belt cutter to rescue the woman. Boatwright's dad works for York County Natural Gas, and recently the company gave that seat belt tool to first responders. Fire crews say they are grateful that Boatwright jumped into action when he did.
Good job. You make our job easier. You know, when somebody is faced in a situation like that, they have to make a moral and ethical decision as to what they're going to do.
Crews who responded will be attending the annual Rock Hill Firefighter Award Ceremony. One from Station 3 has been nominated for Firefighter of the Year, and the two men who helped that woman will be honored as well.
A historic cemetery vandalized for the second time in Lancaster, causing major damage to headstones dating back hundreds of years. At least 23 markers were found smashed and cracked Monday morning at the Old Presbyterian Church Cemetery. It happened just hours after a New Year's Eve party at the classical brass concert there at the Lancaster Cultural Center. John Craig Jr. says they discovered at least 33 fractures in the headstones, some again dating back to the 1800s. The Lancaster County Society for Historical Preservation spent nearly $6,000 to repair the headstones that were damaged back in 2016. They say this will cost them thousands more, and it's certainly frustrating.
Obviously, the desecration of a veteran's monument is particular. I'm a Vietnam vet myself, is particularly hurtful. This is a beautiful spot. It's an important public space, and the whole community benefits from having it. And so it's unfortunate when everyone doesn't appreciate what we have.
Fundraising is needed to cover the cost again of those repairs. If you'd like to donate or learn more about how you can help, you can send a check or stop by the Lancaster Historical Society. The office is on Craig Farm Road, and they're certainly aware they need to look at maybe lighting or fencing or something to try and prevent this from happening again. Well, when George Shepherd entered office as the mayor of TKK, he says the city was in debt. But now, with the help of council, Shepherd says he helped to save $3 million, build a new fire station, and plans for a new police station are on the table now as well.
Well, those accomplishments were celebrated as Shepherd stepped down as mayor and a swearing-in ceremony taking place for the new mayor. CN2's Alexandria Savage with all the action from TKK.
It was a packed house as neighbors and politicians celebrated 10 years of service to the city of TKK and the last eight as mayor as George Shepherd left office and passed the torch to incoming Mayor David O'Neill.
Shepard was sworn into office in 2009, the same year Dottie Hersey took her seat on council.
It was wonderful to get to know so many people in the community and to have a chance to govern. It's a wonderful city, so I will miss seeing people on a regular basis.
Both said goodbye to their office as fresh faces and a familiar one took their new seats.
I've been the mayor pro tem for the last 2 years, and we knew this day was going to eventually happen, so it's always good to have a fresh bunch of fresh ideas, new thoughts, new ideas, and we're just happy. I'm happy to work with these people.
If you would have told me a year ago that I would be sitting here doing this right now, I would have thought you were crazy. So this is my first run at it, and it's been a successful one.
Congressman Ralph Norman was also there to honor the former mayor, who received a standing ovation from his community.
I've always had the philosophy that if you can't get done in 8 years, maybe it shouldn't be done by you. So 8 years, I was done. Move on. Let someone else take over.
Both incoming Mayor David O'Neill and Shepard say they are excited about the coming progress in what Shepard calls one of the safest cities in the Palmetto State.
We're not going to raise taxes, and we're not going to go into debt. So that's the formula we have to work with, to stay out of debt and just pay cash when we need some.
O'Neill, a family man, decided to close the meeting a little differently with the help of his 83-year-old mother.
A special election will be held March 20th to fill David O'Neill's seat since he is now mayor. Shepard left big shoes to fill. He closed by reminding neighbors that TKK, it's the good life. In TKK, Alexandria Savage, CN2 News.
The new TKK mayor, David O'Neill, closed the meeting and ceremony with the help of his 83-year-old mother. She traveled all the way from Texas to see his swearing-in ceremony. Well, the filing will open for David O'Neill's vacated TKK City Council seat starting this Friday, January the 12th at noon. That's next Friday, that is. Next Friday, January the 12th at noon. This election, again, is to fill O'Neill's vacated seat. Filing will close Monday, January the 22nd at noon. Those interested in filing must do so in person at the Office of the Board of Voter Registration and Elections in York County. It's there on South Congress Street in York. There is a filing fee of $25. The special election will take place on Tuesday, March the 20th. Well, here's our latest Arrowpoint Federal Credit Union picture of the day. Henry Kalungi, former Winthrop soccer standout and professional player with the Charlotte Independents, recently returned from his home country of Uganda. Each Christmas, Henry, along with his foundation, returns for an annual Christmas party for underprivileged kids. You want to see your photo as our picture of the day? Just email it to news@cn2.com.
And coming up later in CN2 Sports, 4 football players, 3 band members have been practicing hard this week in Texas.
Plus,
if you get sick and need around-the-clock care, can you afford it? I'm CN2's Indira Esquiva learning more about long-term care insurance in part 1 of our Starting the Conversation series.
Welcome back to CN2 News.
Even though the shopping season is over, you're always in need of a special gift, and there is a magical place hidden in downtown Lancaster. The Hidden Rooster is this week's CN2 Business Spotlight. The store has been open for more than 17 years, but not everyone knows about it. When you step inside, lanterns and decorations hang right from the ceiling, and it's all for sale. The Purple Rooster tells us if you are looking to buy a special present, they are the go-to place.
We specialize in gifts for different occasions, and we do have unique gifts that other stores don't have. We try not to buy from companies that other stores buy.
CN2's Business Spotlight is brought to you by Craig Wilkerson, attorney at law. Knowledge is power. Know your rights.
The store also carries a lot of things for gardening because the owner, Scott's sister, is a landscaper. It's located there on East Gay Street, again in downtown Lancaster. I've been in there, and it is a lovely place.
Well, here's your CN2 7-day forecast. Well, despite the snow and freezing rain hitting South Carolina, we actually will see some sunny skies this Thursday. Highs in the 30s, lows continue to be in the teens.
In tonight's CN2 digital dashboard, it's time once again for our CN2 Comporium winter warm-up. Our annual coat drive goes all month. Just drop off new or gently used coats here at CN2 or at any of our Comporium retail locations. And thanks again for helping us help the United Way, schools, and many others stay warm this year.
Catherine Templeton, conservative candidate for governor of South Carolina, recently in town. She stopped by Red Bull in Rock Hill to speak with business people, entrepreneurs, and members of the medical community. She says it's her pledge to South Carolina that cleaning up the Capitol and ethics reform will be her top priorities if elected as governor.
This week, we're bringing you three in-depth reports. We're calling Starting the Conversation things like planning a funeral and planning for an illness.
We're going to start, though, with long-term care insurance. That would cover the care of a person who can no longer care for themselves independently.
The official word is this. If someone can't do two of the six things of what are called activities of daily living, long-term care insurance would be helpful. Things like eating, bathing, dressing, and using the restroom. After 90 days of not being able to do at least two of those things, long-term care insurance would kick in if you have it. And that's the key. Should you get it? How much does it cost? What does it cover?
Yeah, CN2's Indira Esquiva with that special report tonight.
9 years ago when we moved here, my mother had just passed away. And, you know, I was the likely person to be the one to take care of my dad. So I moved him down here with us. And after that, he went through a very emotional time. And he was hallucinating and getting hurt. So he wasn't able to live alone. I've had to quit several jobs because Dad got sick and I couldn't go into work.
Dina Maris faces a dilemma as old as time. When your parent needs constant care, how do you manage it with your own work and family responsibilities?
It's been hard.
Dina says she did not know about long-term care insurance. Most Americans don't. If her dad had purchased the insurance, they would have been able to more easily afford around-the-clock care.
People oftentimes will, you know, kind of hit the pause button or the snooze button on this issue of long-term care planning.
Jason Jones is an independent advisor who works to help people like the Maris family.
The care that an individual receives for long-term care is not expected to make someone better or to rehabilitate them over time. It's really an ongoing and, as I mentioned, maintenance-oriented type of care.
And it's important to plan for it in advance.
You know, 5 to 7 years before retirement age, someplace between, say, 62 and age 70.
Before you run out of options.
There does come a point, generally by, say, age 85, that there are no more financial planning options available for folks. Which can be quite troublesome.
For Dina's dad, long-term care insurance is no longer a choice, but she hopes her story helps others.
It's been great that I've been able to help him, but at the same time, it's been harder for me.
I couldn't stress enough that this conversation is definitely worth having, and it can have a profound impact.
If you don't get long-term care insurance, on average, families across the country are spending around $100,000 a year to care for their loved ones. That's why experts like Jason strongly encourage people to consider getting the insurance. He says plans cost around $6,000 to $8,000 a year for a couple in their early 60s if they're in fair health and don't smoke. Now, this is a book he shares with clients, ironically with the same title, The Conversation, and it's, again, touching on all of these issues. Now, as for Dina and her dad, since we shot the interview, they moved him to Brookdale, a senior living community here in Rock Hill, and they tell us he is doing very well.
Indira, thank you. Interesting stuff. And this isn't all people need to think about as we get older. So what is next in the series?
Okay, so what are wills? When should you start getting a power of attorney? And where do all these documents live? We found out some interesting things. I mean, I've learned so much myself just from doing this series, and I'm excited to share it all.
Awesome. Indira Esquiva, thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Stay with us, CN2 Sports, right after this. This is CN2 Sports.
The high school football season is over for most, but not for four of our players who have been in San Antonio, Texas all week practicing for the U.S. Army All-American Bowl game. CN2's Danielle DeTomo with your Wednesday sports report.
Give me speed, Ricky. Go. Right now, get your head around.
The Clemson Tigers might have lost their game to Alabama during the Sugar Bowl game on New Year's Day, but they do have something to look forward to from South Point star Darion Kendrick, who will be playing for the Tigers. Right now, he is looking good, practicing for the U.S. Army All-American Bowl this week, the team posting several pictures and videos of Darion on social media. Three other local football players will be playing in the bowl game, including Louisville's Josh Belk. As you see here, he has been dominating in practice. Nation Ford's Skylar DeLong and South Point's B.T. Potter will also be playing. The U.S. Army All-American Bowl will be on NBC at 12 on Saturday.
We'll be right back.
There's also some local high schoolers that will be playing in the U.S. Army All-American Band. That includes South Point's Matthew Benford, Fort Mill's Thomas Fitzpatrick, and Nation Ford's Todd McKinney. These three have been practicing hard all week with the entire band in Texas. Six Tri-County college football players winning their bowl games. Those include Jaleel Scott, who plays for New Mexico State. He helped his team win the Arizona Bowl. Nick McLeod, who plays for North Carolina State, had a huge interception during the Sun Bowl, ending his sophomore year on a positive note. Mason Rudolph, Oklahoma State's quarterback, was the MVP in the Camping World Bowl game. Malik Williams of Appalachian State got the first touchdown of his career in the Mountaineers' blowout in the Dollar General Bowl. Bo Nunn of Appalachian State finished off his college football career winning the Dollar General Bowl, and Zeke Rodney, who plays for Wake Forest, getting the win in the Belk Bowl. And Winthrop University with some exciting news. The spring schedule for the 19-time Big South champion Winthrop women's tennis team is now available. The Eagles will host 8 home matches and play 13 on the road. They will open up their spring season with the ITA kickoff event, which will be at UNC Chapel Hill. Winthrop is also set to host the 2018 Big South Conference Championship for men's and women's tennis. That will be on April 17th through the 20th. Reporting for CN2 Sports on this Wednesday, I'm Danielle DeTomo.
All right, thanks, Danielle.
And thank you for being here. See you tomorrow.
Good night.